We are delighted to welcome Rob Reiman to this public affairs program. He will be discussing the ideas put forward in his book, To Fight Against This Age, on fascism and humanism. Rob is based in the Netherlands and is the founder of the Nexus Institute.
Downtown New York, only a week ago, I saw a billboard with just two lines. The first line was, it won't happen to us. And below, this is not an emergency plan. And I thought, this is brilliant. It won't happen to us. This is not an emergency plan. And it reminded me of this brilliant novel of Sinclair Lewis in 1935, It Can't Happen to Us, which, as you recollect, was, you know, this satire on that he imagines that Franklin Roosevelt will lose the election to his character Winthrop, who will create in America a kind of plutocratic totalitarian state, not unlike what is happening at the time in Nazi Germany. The difference between this Winthrop figure and Hitler is that Hitler is an ideologue, but this Winthrop, maybe he's a con man, he's a manipulator, and he has no ideology like Hitler. Now, the story in real life, of course, was much more hopeful. Franklin Roosevelt won the elections. He could stand up against, quote unquote, the plot against America. And mainly due to him, in 1945, fascist Europe was defeated forever. Now, that was the question which haunted a young French novelist, intellectual, who in March 1946 came to New York. And he was young, he had only published one novel, but there was already a buzz around him. I'm talking about Albert Camus, who wrote his book, L'Étranger, The Stranger. And that's the kind of novel which, you know, tries to explain, you know, how absurd life is, how meaningless it is, you know, given all the things that had happened in Europe. So 3 days after his arrival at Columbia, the Miller Theater, he would give a talk. And normally you can, well, it was, I think, around 700 stage of places, and there were more than 1,200 students coming to listen to Albert Camus. Those who expected Camus to talk more about how absurd life is, how meaningless it is, probably would have been very surprised. We don't have the lecture, we only have notes of what Camus then said at March 1946. But based on the notes, we know that he said the following. My generation in Europe, told Camus, was born at the beginning of World War I. We were adolescents at the time of the Great Depression, and a few years later, the rise of Hitler in Germany, civil war in Spain, and in 1938, the betrayal of Munich. And then Second World War, Hitler in our country. Born and bred in such a world, what is it that we could believe in? In nothing. The world in which we were called to exist was an absurd world with no place to find reviews because the world of culture was too beautiful to be true. And so when we had to face Hitler and his Nazis, which values could we oppose to him? None. None, because what we were facing was much worse than the bankruptcy of a political system. This fascism came from the root of our society, which was fundamentally a society deprived of any moral and spiritual values. The violence of fascism was just its logical consequence. Yet, this fascist society, we had to fight it. And we did. But now Hitler is gone. We know one thing for certain. The poison of fascism has not been eliminated at all. It still exists. More than that, it is still present in each of us, who still thinks in terms of power, efficiency, and historical task in which ordinary people are sacrificed for a political goal. And a year later, 1947, Camus publishes his very brilliant novel, La Peste, The Plague, to tell us that fascism will never be defeated forever. Fascism, he wants his readers to understand, is like a bacillus, a virus that never dies and never disappears for good, as it can and will come back to destroy a democracy from inside. That same year, another German who find a place here in this country, Thomas Mann. Thomas Mann, who came here in 1938 and was well connected, he was very much befriended with the mother of Catherine Graham, Agnes Meyer. Due to her, he could give lectures at the Library of Congress. He was befriended with Roosevelt. Was probably the last European who could spend weeks in the White House at the invitation of the president. But anyway, in 1947, he gives a lecture and he says, he makes the same point. He said, the war is over, but please don't make the mistake. Fascism did not disappear. It is not over. It can and will come back. Why? Why? Well, again, before the war, in 1938, when he arrived here, and which turned out, you know, the beginning of his exile, he came with a very important lecture called The Coming Victory of Democracy. It was a coast-to-coast lecture from here to San Francisco, 40 town halls with thousands of Americans, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 6,000, literally people to listen to a lecture of more than 2 hours. And then he makes the following argument. He says, look, in my hometown, Munich, I have witnessed the rise of Hitler. I was living there, he was living there, and I have seen how a fascist movement came to power all over Europe. He had seen how the spirit of democracy can disappear in a mass society where demagogues are welcomed with their politics of resentment, the incitement of anger and fear, xenophobia, the need for scapegoats, and its hatred of the life of the mind. And so with this experience, he wanted the Americans to understand what democracy is really all about. And he says, look, what I got to learn, what I got to know is that democracy is, quote unquote, that form of government and society which is inspired above every other with the feeling and consciousness of the dignity of man. And he says, well, these are big words, and I'm very well aware of how petty we can be, that we are all can be the victims of, you know, our own egotism and cruelty and stupidity, etc. But precisely for that reason, he urged us never to forget that the great and honorable in men manifest themselves as art and science, a passion for truth, the creation of beauty, and the idea of justice. And these are the things a true democracy will cultivate, because it wants to be that form of government that attempts to elevate human beings and to enable them to think critically and to be free. Now, let's be honest, okay? This is not our democracy. Instead of equal chances and equal rights, there is a growing inequality and exclusion. Instead of elevating people, there is the ongoing dumping down everywhere. Instead of the cultivation of universal moral and spiritual values, we cultivate mainly the values of the commercial world. Productivity, efficiency, quantity, usefulness, and an aggressive materialism that dominates the whole society. Our commercial culture has no interest in reason, truth, beauty, and justice. It only activates our lowest instincts. And instead of compassion, there is resentment, there is racism, there is fear, and there is hatred. And instead of a serious political, intellectual discussion about the way forward to create a better society together, there is nothing more than tribal politics, Twitter slogans, propaganda, and image building. Now, crucial to understand that the true spirit of our society is a society of kitsch. Now, in general, people think that kitsch is just bad art, but that's a mistake. Kitsch is the mindset of a society that has given up on the cultivation of moral and spiritual values. And so at its core, A kitsch culture is completely meaningless. Yet all of this remains concealed behind the cultivation, even the idolatry, of our basic instincts and desires, as they have to fill the spiritual void. How does a kitsch society, how does it look like, you know, in practice? Well, in a kitsch society, our identity is no longer based on who I am, but what I have. And our constant compulsion to buy and to possess is therefore not much a manifestation of greed, as it is this deep longing to have an identity and then to show it off to many people as possible, and with the expectation and hope that they will like you, right? The likes are becoming very, very important. The life of the mind in a kitsch society is no longer relevant. It's all about feeling good. And you feel best if everything is nice and therefore pleasant. So pleasant will become the absolute measure of everything you spend your time on. Your work, your relationship, what you do in leisure time. And at the very mad moment, you know, that you're no longer feeling very happy, there is Ritalin or other drugs. The use of Ritalin in this society is already above 25% among youngsters. Religion, for example, will no longer be the call to change your life and to have compassion with your fellow human beings, but it will become the indulgence in self-righteousness and higher feelings. And Mr. Ray Moore and Mr. Steve Bannon are prime examples of this kitsch religion. Another crucial consequence is that the quest for quality, which is a spiritual value, will be replaced by the longing for quantity. So everything has to be big. And in the kitsch world, the best is, by definition, the biggest number. But it was always a bigger number, so it will never be enough. Now combine the dominance of materialism with the faith in quantity, and you understand why in this kitsch society, we will always idealize the desire to be rich, and the rich as being the true heroes of our time. And in this respect, it is only logic that education in that kitsch world is reduced to an instrument for the transfer of everything useful and knowledge that is usable for the economy and everything you need to know in order to earn money. Emotions and irrationalism will prevail, because reason and the act of thinking makes life too complicated, and in the kitsch culture, nothing is allowed that is difficult, because everything has to be fun, easy, cool, hip, sexy, entertaining. And in such a society, you can wait for the king of kitsch, whom his followers believe as to be the new messiah, who will cure society of all evils and make them happy again and the country great again. Now, Europe and the USA have two different histories, right? Fascism has been part of our history for decades. And not only in Italy or in Germany, but in Spain, in France, in the Netherlands, in Central Europe, it was everywhere for decades. I presume that the USA, because of its own history, there is here a greater sensitivity for racism. But we Europeans have a greater sensitivity for fascism, again, because it has been part of our history for so long. And so Albert Camus and Thomas Mann, who both lived through the fascist era in Europe, were absolutely right. Fascism is a political phenomenon that will never disappear, as it is the dark side of every democracy. And so when our democracy degenerates into this kitsch society, whereby demagogues, stupidity, propaganda, vulgarity, and the lowest human instincts increase their dominance, that will inevitably give birth to that bastard child of democracy, which is fascism. Everything changes over time, okay? 2 years from now, 5 years from now, all of us will be different. And yet we are still the same. Now, it's the same with fascism. When it returns, it will be different from how we have seen it in the time of Mussolini and Hitler. And still, it will be the same. The fascist mindset in our time will not present itself in black uniforms or strange crosses or silly gestures. And of course, every fascist will deny to be a fascist, okay? But the character of the mindset of fascism will not have changed. And this is how you recognize it. Not by its ideology, because it doesn't have an ideology. This is one of the basic mistakes made by so many political scientists. It doesn't have an ideology. But the characteristics are always the same. So let me just mention a few. The new fascist leader will present himself, most of the time it will be a him, as the anti-politician, the strongman, the leader, who will cure society from all social evil. And knowing that that's not true, as the false messiah of a secular religion, he has no other choice than to deceive his millions of believers with slogans, the false promise of a return to a never-existing past, a rich and never-ending variety of enemies to exploit their resentment and fear, and last but not least, with endless propaganda to manipulate their habits and opinions. He has no other interest than self-interest, and his lack of ideas and vision will be hidden by blaming all kinds of scapegoats, and his disinterest in the rest of the world promoted as a brilliant strategy to make his own country great again. His worldview will be profoundly materialistic and favor extreme nationalism. He will be a pathological liar. They are all pathological liars. And his politics of lies underscores how right Thomas Mann was when in 1940 he gave a lecture in LA entitled War on Democracy, when he warned the audience, I quote, "Let me tell you the whole truth. If ever fascism should come to America, it will come in the name of freedom." The fascist leader, the fascist mindset, is always the mindset of an anti-democrat who despises the free press and prefers to make any judge he doesn't like suspect. And the habit to Twitter, indulging in name-calling, and avoid any serious intellectual debate is exemplary of the populist demagogue who despises the life of the mind and the spirit of democracy. The fascist leader will demand an unconditional loyalty and his incapability to accept any form of criticism, plus his self-image of being a genius, always characterizes the authoritarian. Now, these characteristics of the quintessential fascist mindset are characteristics of Mr. Orban in Hungary, Putin in Russia, Erdogan in Turkey, Wilders in the Netherlands, Madame Le Pen in France, Kaczynski in Poland, Zeman in the Czech Republic, the fascist leaders in Austria, Germany, and last but not least, indeed, Mr. Donald Trump. Now, many people get it, but interestingly enough, many in the elites, the pundits, the academics, the politicians, remain in a state of denial. The F word is their biggest taboo, and they will not use it. What we get instead is a whole series of euphemism, populism, right-wing populism, and new words like Putinism, or Trumpism, or Trumpocracy. It's a big, big blind spot. And look, the blindness, just to give you one horrific example of how blind people can be, a great man like Winston Churchill, and God bless Winston Churchill, but on February 18, 1933, February 1933, so Hitler was already in power in Nazi Germany, he gave a speech at the Anti-Socialist League in London, in which he said, quote unquote, "Mussolini is a great man, he's the genius of our time, he's a true lawgiver, and his fascism will be the strategy for our future." Quote unquote, Churchill, February 1933. It took him a few more years to understand what the real nature of fascism is. Okay, so I can understand the blindness, but it is dangerous as it is stupid. Look, I understand, we all understand that inconvenient truths are never welcome, not in your private life, not as a society. And the common response is natural. The common response is denial. No, this cannot be true. But as I said, it is as stupid as it is dangerous. Now, many of you will remember the Club of Rome, which was founded in 1968 and published their report on the limits of growth in 1972. And basically, it was the very first study of the consequences of an ongoing economic growth in our industrial society for our climate. And the general response in 1972 was denial. No, this cannot be true. You know, things are not that serious. Things will get better. Da-da-da-da-da. Well, we know what happened, and it took them decades to realize that the Club of Rome in 1972 was already right. And if they would have accepted that truth in 1972, our situation for the planet Earth would be much, much better. Now, it possibly is already too late. God knows. And the same thing is happening right now. And the key argument that there is no return of fascism and that Trump is not a fascist is he is not a Hitler. Well, yes, that's true. He's not a Hitler. But this is not relevant. There were many more fascists. And all argument, his actions are not violent. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you that his politics should not be compared with World War II. His politics should be compared with the time of its inception, the 20s. And you really does not need a PhD in psychology to understand that with his racist rhoric, his divisiveness due to the politics of fear and hatred, he will incite, bit by bit, more and more violence in your own society and in the world, starting 2019 with, you know, this embassy going to Jerusalem. It will be a disaster. And the trouble with all those new words like Trumpism and Trumpocracy is that we are missing both the global and historical dimension of what is happening. And next to that, too much of all the books about what is happening right now inside the White House, which indeed within 1 year has been transformed into a hothouse of voids and corruption and lies and propaganda, but it caters to the hunger of sensation, and it is a distraction from the true story. With all respect to Michael Wolff and his book, Fire and Fury, look, you can say a lot of things about Donald Trump, but not that he has ever been shy about the guy he is, right? I mean, so there's not that much new in this book. Well, okay, the ego of Steve Bannon is even bigger than that of Donald Trump, but we are missing, it's a distraction because we are missing the true story. And the true story is not what is happening in the White House, but what happened so that a man like Donald Trump could get into the White House. And probably the media are not focused on this because they are too complicit with getting the guy into the White House. The true story is not that Trump is the cause of the crisis of our democracy, but that he is an expression of our democracy in crisis. The true story is not that we are dealing with a political crisis, but with a moral crisis in our society. The true story is that our elites will not solve the crisis because their mindset is the crisis. This is very important, right? Elites in power have always an instinct, you know, to keep the status quo, because if the society really would change, they will lose their position. The true story is that we are no longer living in a true democracy because its spirit is gone and due to a deep defect in our culture. And because of that, we are now facing as a consequence that all over the West was this return of fascism as the true anti-democratic spirit. I'll finish this talk with a very short handout. A few don'ts and one important to-do. The don'ts. Please stop the denial and be aware that those who continue to deny and keep on talking in terms of neologisms and euphemisms are all ignorant or opportunistic or fascist themselves. Two. Fascism, being the political expression of a defect in our culture, is not something that can be fixed. So science and technology will not do. Three, we are confronting with a much bigger threat than an economic crisis. So stop thinking that with more economic growth, all will be fine. That will not be the case. Four, don't think that political activism is enough. Yes, hopefully. In 2018, November, there will be already a change. Hopefully, 2020 will be even a bigger change. But even with the disappearance of Trump and his gang. The bacillus of fascism will not have disappeared. So here's the to-do. Use the second chapter of this book to think and work together on a new counterculture. A counterculture in which there is no longer place for stupidity, in which there is no longer place for kids and conformism, but to have a counterculture that will educate us in the human capacity to transcend ourselves, to have imagination and empathy, to live in truth, to create beauty, and to do justice. And this is never easy. It has never been easy. But this is the true greatness of honoring the dignity of every human being. And this is what the democratic civilization is all about. And this is what already in 1938, Thomas Mann, here in America, called an education in the nobility of spirit, with its enduring call never to conform to the world as it is, but to be brave and accept your moral responsibility to fight against the return of fascism and the survival of the spirit of democracy. Thank you so much.
For more on this program and other Carnegie Ethics Studio productions, visit carnegiecouncil.org. There you can find video highlights, transcripts, audio recordings, and other multimedia resources on global ethics. This program is made possible by the Carnegie Ethics Studio and viewers like you.